Hey, what's up everybody? Welcome back to my channel. If you're new to this channel, folks, welcome on board to the community of passionate changemakers. Joshua Partugi here, recording right from Brisbane, Australia. That is right, from down under. I hope you're having an awesome day today, folks. And I hope you're delivering something amazing for your customers. Now, as some of you may have already noticed, especially those of you who are longtime subscribers, I haven't uploaded any new videos for a few weeks already. So I have started traveling again, and I did some consulting gigs, and I facilitated several public and private in-person training. Now, during the consulting gigs and during the classes that I facilitated, I get tons of questions. And the common question that I got from people was about, how do you actually measure the Scrum team's effectiveness? Now, some of you already know, the Scrum team's effectiveness is one of the Scrum Master's accountability. If you've also been wondering about how to actually measure the Scrum team's effectiveness, and if you still haven't found the answer, stick around, folks, because we will break it down right after this. We have to acknowledge that people in management likes to measure. They like measurements. And there's a common saying in management, if you cannot measure it, then you cannot manage it. In the past, I tried to shy away from any question that is related with measuring the Scrum team. Because quite often, from my personal observation, the Scrum team members being measured tend to work individually to achieve the number that has been put against them, rather than to collaborate with one another to develop valuable product for the customers. But over time, I have learned that there is nothing wrong with measurements. And I have also learned that those unexpected behaviors in the Scrum team are caused by the wrong measurements applied to the team, like velocity, for example. But the right measurement will actually drive the right behavior. In the past 2 years, I have also gotten pushback from several Scrum Masters whenever I explain to them about their accountabilities. I'm actually quite disappointed seeing Scrum Masters resist being made accountable. In a professional context in the corporate world, knowing what Scrum Masters' accountability is important so that we know what we can expect from the Scrum Masters. Even before the Scrum Guide version 2020, the accountability of the product owner has always been clear. That is maximizing the value of the product. And the accountability of the developers in the Scrum team has always been clear also. That is to deliver high quality products. We can measure both the value and the quality of the product. But prior to Scrum Guide 2020, there is no clear accountability defined for the Scrum Master. And from my personal observation, this has caused some companies to wonder about the value of having a Scrum Master in the company, because the Scrum Master's accountability is not even clearly stated. And from my personal observation, some companies perceive that Scrum Master is a secretarial or administrative role for the Scrum team, and they put several more roles on top of the Scrum Master to manage the Scrum Master, which is like a paradox, because the Scrum Master who is supposed to promote self-management in the Scrum team is being managed. In Scrum Guide 2020, the accountability for the Scrum Master is clearly defined. But we have another problem. What measurement shall be used so that people in the company know that the Scrum Master is already accountable with the Scrum team's effectiveness? And that's what we want to break down in today's video. Before we get into the measurements for Scrum team's effectiveness, let's first look at the nature of Scrum itself so that we know what effective means from Scrum perspective. As we already know, Scrum is an iterative and incremental framework for product delivery. The iteration for delivering a usable product increment is called the sprint. Scrum requires that the product increment resulting from the sprint is at a state where it can be used by the user. What the Scrum team needs to do to ensure that the product increment is always at a releasable state is defined in the definition of done. In Scrum, progress is measured by whether the product increment delivered every sprint is always at a releasable state. So to know whether the Scrum team is effective is by measuring how many times a releasable product increment is delivered every sprint. Scrum requires that at least one releasable increment is delivered in a sprint. This does not mean the Scrum team should meet all of the sprint backlog they have planned during sprint planning. During sprint planning, the Scrum team could have planned for 5 sprint backlog, but at the end of the sprint only delivered 3 sprint backlog. But if this 3 sprint backlog form a releasable increment that meets the sprint goal, the Scrum team have reached the first level of effectiveness. Effective in Scrum is not about meeting the iron triangle on time, on scope, and on budget. In Scrum, effective means delivering at least one releasable increment that meets the sprint goal every single sprint. The Scrum team can deliver less scope but still achieve the sprint goal. But just hang with me for a few more minutes. Let's take this even further, because delivering one releasable increment every sprint is the bare minimum requirement. Awesome Scrum teams strive for excellence. They continuously improve their level of effectiveness. If the Scrum team is practicing continuous delivery or DevOps practices and delivered releasable increments multiple times within a sprint, the Scrum team have reached the second level of effectiveness. Some Scrum teams are able to deliver releasable increments once a day. And if they're using a 2-week sprint, they deliver at least 10 releasable increments in one sprint. So the first step in measuring the Scrum team's effectiveness is to measure and to visualize how many times the Scrum team deliver releasable increments from sprint to sprint. As I mentioned earlier, the Scrum team does not require to release the increment to the production environment every sprint. As written on Scrum Guide, the sprint review should not be a phase gate for delivering value. If the product owner knows the Scrum team always delivers releasable increments multiple times in a sprint, the product owner may choose to release those increments to the production environment before the sprint review to gain competitive advantage in the market and also to make the sprint review more outcome-oriented. Now, if the Scrum team releases to the production environment multiple times in the sprint before the sprint review, they have reached the third level of Scrum team's effectiveness. Besides measuring the frequency of a releasable increment delivered per sprint, the next metric for measuring Scrum team's effectiveness is release frequency. For teams who still practice water Scrumfall, where the sprints is only for development, and they leave out testing and integration at the very end of the project lifecycle, these Scrum teams still have rooms for improvement, at least to reach the first level of effectiveness, because currently their sprint does not result with at least one releasable increment. Now, we have to acknowledge that delivering releasable increments every sprint requires adaptation and new capability. There are many things that the Scrum Master can do to leverage the team capability so that the team can deliver releasable increments every sprint. If the Scrum Master has the technical capability, the Scrum Master can teach and mentor the team on technical practices that can help the team deliver releasable increments every sprint. But if the Scrum Master does not have the technical capability, the Scrum Master can get a trainer to teach the team on technical practices needed. If those trainers are from outside of the company, the Scrum Master can seek for training budget either from the product owner or from the management. When we look at the evidence-based management guide, the frequency of releasable increment delivered per sprint is under the ability to innovate key value area. The ability to innovate key value area contains all of the metrics to measure the Scrum team's effectiveness. If you haven't read the evidence-based management guide, you can go to this URL to download the latest EBM guide from scrum.org website. I'm not going to explain every single metric defined in the EBM guide in today's video. Let's continue our discussion. Besides technical capability, other possible reasons why the Scrum team are not able to deliver releasable increments in a sprint is because the Scrum team is interrupted with many production incidents during the sprint. The frequency production incidents interrupts the Scrum team can also be measured. Another possible reason is because the product the Scrum team is developing has too many technical debts. Technical debts can be measured using tools like Sonar. Technical debts often relate with defect trends that we see from sprint to sprint. We can also measure defect trends and visualize it using a chart. Another reason why the Scrum team cannot deliver releasable increments every sprint is because they're multitasking on multiple products, and there is time wasted for context switching. The amount of time context switching can be measured also. Besides context switching between multiple products, context switching to support different versions of the product might be another reason that the Scrum team is ineffective in delivering releasable increments every sprint. In the EBM guide, this metric is called the installed version index. All of these metrics, production incident trends, technical debts, defect trends, time spent context switching, installed version index, and on-product index is part of the ability to innovate key value area. So basically, if you are seeing improvement from sprint to sprint in the ability to innovate metrics, then you know that your Scrum Master is being accountable for the Scrum Team's effectiveness and they're doing their job well. You can make a dashboard that displays the ability to innovate metrics. The Scrum Team can discuss the ability to innovate metrics during the sprint retrospectives so they can discover further improvements that can improve their level of effectiveness. Now folks, if I can summarize Scrum into one purpose, it is to deliver releasable increments every single sprint. All of the artifacts, the events in Scrum are there to achieve this single purpose. Enterprise agility or even agile maturity should not be measured by how religious are people in the company in following all of those plethora of agile practices available in the market. But instead, agility should be measured by how effective or how capable are people in the company in delivering releasable, valuable increments consistently in shortest time possible. Your company can do so many agile practices available in the market, but yet the team is still ineffective in value delivery. Focus on improving people's capability rather than just on following all of the agile practices. To understand which areas you should improve next, you can start with defining and tracking the ability to innovate metrics. Now, I have made a sample EBM dashboard to give you a starting point to craft your own EBM dashboard. The link to the EBM dashboard is in the description section down below. Thank you for watching today's video, folks. I hope more Scrum Masters in your company can become more accountable for the Scrum Team's effectiveness. And I hope you are inspired to make a change that will improve your company's state of agility. And if you like today's video, don't forget to click that like button down below. And also don't forget to subscribe to this channel, folks. I will see you in the next video. Now deliver something amazing for your customers. Bye now.